Elijah's fear was more than he could take. Jezebel's threat caused him to forget who God was and all that God had done for him. His fear overwhelmed him, and so he fled into the wilderness. The wilderness is a tough place. In the Bible, the wilderness is a place of wandering. It's a place of abandonment, a place of isolation, a place of searching. For Elijah is where he wrestled with his pain and his brokenness. But as he wandered, he grew tired, and so he stopped and he took rest under a solitary tree. And it is there that he begged God to simply let him die. He didn't want to go on any longer. Hearing no answer from God, he fell asleep. And when he woke, God had provided for him food and drink. But God also provided a plan. God told him to journey deeper into the wilderness until he could reach Horeb, which is another name for Sinai. You might remember this name from the Exodus story. This is where God led the people after he had taken them out of Egypt in slavery. This is where Moses went up the mountain and received the law. And so God calls to Elijah to ascend the mountain as Moses had done before him and take rest in a cave. Once in the cave, God called to Elijah and asked him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" Elijah answered, "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away." So God told Elijah to go to the mouth of the cave and stand there, and he would pass by him. And our scripture says, "Now there was a great wind so strong that it was splitting mountains and breaking rocks into pieces. But God wasn't in the wind. After the wind, an earthquake. But God wasn't in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But God wasn't in the fire. And after the fire, a sound of sheer silence." I really like how the King James Version translates this sheer silence as a still, small voice. Amidst the chaos, amidst the noise, amidst the destruction, God was heard in a still, small voice. I give my kids a hard time because they can't handle silence. For many of us today, the noise is a constant, especially for young people who just seem to crave it. I'm almost as bad as they are, as I always have the TV on in the background, but I also need my silence from time to time. Do you remember back to last year's Christmas play? The Grinch had moved to the highest peak on the mountain to get away from the noise, but at Christmas time, the noise was still so loud that it still reached him, even up on the highest mountaintop. I'm not so sure that the Grinch was such a bad guy after all. He simply needed his silence. And so he hated Christmas because he associated Christmas with noise, noise, noise. In our world, the noise is a constant. Several applicants were seeking a position as a ship's Morse code operator, and they showed up to interview for the job. While they were waiting in the room, there was a lot of conversation filling the room. And so they couldn't hear the dots and dashes that were emanating over the intercom. Then another applicant came in and sat down. But after just a few moments, she jumped in, walked into the office, and after a few moments, she emerged having gotten the job. The other applicants exclaimed, "We were here first. How could you show up and get the job?" To which she replied, "Any of you could have gotten this job if you had just been quiet long enough to pay attention to the message." What message, then? The code said the ship's operator must always be on alert. The first person who gets this message and comes directly to my office will get the job. The question is, if God wasn't in the wind or in the earthquake or in the fire, if God wasn't in the chaos and the noise, and if the noise is all that we hear, How can we ever expect to hear God? How can we ever hear the still small voice that is begging us to listen if we never hear the silence? Now there was a great wind so strong that it was splitting mountains and breaking rocks in pieces, but God wasn't in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake, but God wasn't in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire, but God wasn't in the fire. And after the fire, there was a still, small voice. And when Elijah heard it, God asked again, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" And Elijah gives the same answer that he gave to him before. "I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the Israelites have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. I alone am left, and they are seeking my life to take it away." God was trying to snap Elijah out of his funk that he was in. He was trying to wake Elijah up. God had come to Elijah in his pain and in his brokenness, and God had revealed his power to him. God reminded him that God is in control. He is the God who brings the wind, the earthquake, and the fire. God is the God whom Moses had to remove his sandals, because when he was on this very mountain, he stood on holy ground. God is the God who was with Elijah on Mount Carmel. And God is the God who has been with him through all the things that he has faced before. But Elijah was unchanged. Elijah was unmoved by the presence of God. Elijah could simply hit the snooze button, the button that allows us to go back to sleep just for a few more minutes before it is time to wake up and face our day. And so God knew that Elijah was done. So God told him, "Go back the very way you came, and on into the wilderness of Damascus. When you get there, anoint Hazael as king of Aram. Also anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, as king of Israel. And anoint Elisha, son of Shaphat, of El-Meholah, to succeed you as prophet." We don't know how Elijah received this word. Maybe it hit him like a ton of bricks, as what he heard was that God simply didn't need him anymore. Or maybe it was a huge relief. Maybe he was just ready to move on. No matter. If we were to read on in our scripture, we would find that Elijah does at least the last part of what God asked him to do. He goes and he finds Elisha plowing the fields. So he approaches him, and we hear that as he passed by, he threw his mantle over him. This is a ceremony of sorts in which the title of prophet is given to someone. Elijah was anointing Elisha, the new prophet. But as quickly as he did this, Elijah tried to go on his way. But Elisha comes down, and he runs after him, and he promises that if Elijah will just wait a few moments, then he will go with him. Again, we really don't know how Elijah reacts to this request, but we do know that Elisha slaughters the oxen and prepares a feast for everyone, says goodbye to his parents, and then he leaves with Elijah and becomes his disciple. And so as 1 Kings 19 comes to a close, we are left with a troubling and tragic picture of the once great Elijah who has been asked to step down. And now he seems to be licking his wounds a bit as he is simply trying to move on. But Elisha won't let him. Elisha essentially thrusts himself onto Elijah, who seems to become the unwilling teacher. Next week, when we pick up our story, we will find that Elijah has finally reawakened. He is revived to his work with the Lord. And over the next several years, Elijah will continue his ministry of mentoring Elisha while also fighting King Ahab. And Elisha becomes a great comfort and encouragement to Elijah. And in the process, Elijah learns once again that he is not alone. Remember, when God asked him twice what he was doing there, Elijah responded both times saying that he and he alone was left to carry on the work of the Lord. But Elijah learned from Elisha that Elisha was just one of several prophets that God was still using to call the people to live a more righteous life. And so Elijah learns too that God is not done with him yet. But what I want to close with today is this. It wasn't until after I began to work on this sermon that it occurred to me that we had been together for at least a year next week. And it wasn't until I was almost done with this sermon that I realized and saw myself and you in the story. I am by no means comparing myself to Elijah or to a great prophet or to any great pastor for that matter, for my story is obviously very different from theirs. But as I shared 18 months ago, I found myself in a place where I just wasn't sure if I was going to continue on as a pastor. When I decided that I was going to leave Westminster Presbyterian Church, I looked around and I asked the presbytery if there were any other positions in the presbytery. But I was told that there was only a few small